And we're live.
And David Carradine is visibly drunk throughout the production. He's just like, yeah, what are we going to do tonight? And he's just like, David Carradine's just drunk on screen. He's not acting. His character isn't supposed to be drunk right now. He's just drunk.
I thought you were like, oh yeah, he was like, oh, Daniel Day-Lewis was supposed to play an alcoholic, so he became physically dependent on alcohol. And it's like this guy is like, oh no, you're supposed to be like an accountant. He's like, what kind of accountant? And it kind of strinks down my gullet.
That happens. So that doesn't work well. Like actors who like are supposed to be portraying a drunk person actually getting drunk, like rarely does that actually work. Like Robert Shaw in Jaws is a perfect example of that. When he's doing the whole USS Indianapolis speech, you know, they're down below decks. It's like the second night of their journey out to get the shark. And he's like, they're showing off scars, him and what's his name from Close Encounters of the Third Kind, fella. They're showing off scars. He's like, yeah, stingray off the coast of Malta. And he's like, oh yeah, well, this is a thresher shark, you know, this and that. And they're showing it. And he's like, what about that one? And he gets all quiet. He starts telling the story of the USS Indianapolis. And it's probably the best scene in the whole movie. The first day they filmed that, he got shithouse drunk because the characters, they're drinking. Mm-hmm. He got shithouse drunk and it's awful. And Spielberg's just like, that didn't work. That didn't work at all. So well, like they came back the next day, he did it sober, killed it. It's a wonderful performance.
You wouldn't want to be shitty drunk if you're playing a drunk person. But I feel like having a couple drinks, few drinks before, might make it easier. Like you're like, oh yeah, I'm feeling the alcohol in me. I'm supposed to be acting drunk, like amp it up. But I guess a professional act. But yeah, like straight up, like if Nick Cage was blackout drunk for every scene and leaving Las Vegas, it's like, yeah, of course that wouldn't have worked.
I'm pretty sure Nick Cage was drunk for that scene in Mandy. When he's guzzling that bottle of vodka, like you can tell from the camera work in that scene, they don't know what he's going to do.
Really?
Yeah. You can tell by the way it's shot that they're, because like they'll zoom in and they'll be like, whoa, hang on, zoom back out. What's he going to do now? Because he's just getting so wild. Like they don't know. He's improvising. He's clearly improvising because like the cameraman doesn't know what and when to zoom in on. Like he's every now and then he just gets a little wild and starts screaming and guzzling the vodka and pouring it on his wounds and just, and then they get that commercial when he goes outside that's just so juxtaposed with what just happened with that like, puke monster with the macaroni and cheese. Mandy is another one of those movies that is just instant classic for me.
Yeah, I liked it a lot.
I loved everything about it. One thing that I've got a real soft spot for in movies is that 80s synth stuff. It's one of the things that I like a lot about John Carpenter and the music that he made for his films. That 80s synth music really does something for me, and I liked that in Mandy. I like the scenes of animation they threw in there, and I like a good revenge story.
Trippy. All the lights, the weird lighting that's kind of unnerving. I liked that.
Yeah, yeah. I really dug Mandy. It's one of the best acid trips.
That and like Leaving Las Vegas, I think, are the two movies I've seen for him. And I'm like, yeah, he was actually really good in that.
Have you seen The Color of Purple?
No.
Or The Color Purple. It's one of the others. He made it right after Mandy, and I was like, is this the resurgence of Nicolas Cage? Has he like found his genre, these wackadoo sci-fi picks? Mm-hmm. Like not that Mandy was exactly sci-fi, but it had a vibe to it. You know, those bikers were almost supernatural and with their vibe about them. The color, it's either The Color of Purple or The Color Purple. I don't recall exactly.
The Color Out of Space.
Oh, is that it?
Color Out. Yeah. Oh, I may have seen that.
Yeah, the
thing in purple the one because there was so much purple.
Yeah, there was a lot of purple.
Yeah, that's it.
Oh, and just a quick aside, the guy who directed, to kind of tie this back to what we were talking about earlier, Panos Cosmatos, or Cosmatos, is the son of George P. Cosmatos, who directed Leviathan. So kind of continuing with the director's thing.
Interesting.
Yeah, Color Out of Space is this weird thing where like Nicolas Cage and his family are in like this farmhouse. They've moved out of the big city. The wife has been recovering from cancer, and they've just kind of gotten away from it all. And then like interdimensional aliens come into play, and all of a sudden there's a lot of practical creature body horror effects with like cows turning into tentacle monsters, and or maybe it's sheep or something like that. I've only seen it once. And then like I'm not going to spoil it for anybody who might want to watch it. It's worth watching.
You didn't like it?
I liked it. Oh, I liked it. It wasn't as good as Mandy, but like Woody hates Mandy. But
I don't know why. Mandy was good.
When we recommended Mandy to Woody, and he watched it, and he said that like a quarter of the way, a third of the way through it, he thought we had played a trick on him. They found the worst, shittiest movie they could, built it up like it was good, so I'd go watch it. Now here I am wasting my time. Those fucks.
I did. And then when I told you about that, you're like, what? No, we really like it. We had that conversation twice, and I still wasn't sure. I've come around to think that you actually like that movie, although I can't relate to like.
Not only do I like it, but I watched it with like a group of eight guys, and at the end, we had an hour-long discussion where we're all just creaming over it. We're just like, and can you believe the colors? Oh, the color skips, the way they change with his emotions, and when he finally does that acid, the way the music changes, and it gets super surreal. And then there's that scene with the black guy from Predator where he's going to get his like crossbow or whatever, and he's like, crazy fucking Jesus freaks, they fucking killed her. And he's just like, his acting performance is actually good. Man has an Oscar. That's what I always have to say.
Yes, he does. Cage. He does. Like,
he's got an Oscar. All right. All right. He's got an Oscar.
I'm interested in Cecil's take on Mandy, since it's a little split here. Kyle and I like it. Woody doesn't. Did you see Mandy, Cecil? I'm sure you did.
Yeah. I saw it. I liked it because it was just really weird. I think it was one of those rare occasions where I do agree where they just kind of turned the cameras on and said, all right, Nicolas Cage, go. And he went. And I think that it's a unique movie. It's a very colorful movie. It's not like anything else. And it's a movie where I can absolutely understand both sides of it. I can understand if you really love it, and I can understand if you really hate it. Some movies I'm kind of like, how can people not like this? Or how can people like this? But this is one where I absolutely understand because it is so bizarre. Mm-hmm. It's one of those movies where they knew while they were making it that this was going to be a cult film, that this was going to be a film that was love it or hate it. There's really nobody like.
I understand why Woody doesn't like it. But it just really appeals to me. Like I like the chainsaw fight. Like there's a scene where like they have a chainsaw fight. Nicolas Cage is like, I've got a chainsaw, and the other guy's like, I have the biggest chainsaw you've ever even heard of. Like the blade is literally 6 feet long or something like that. And they have like a chainsaw fight, chainsaw v chainsaw.
Every action scene in that movie is the cinematic equivalent of children on the kitchen floor banging pots and pans.
I thought it was good.
Just chaos and disorder.
I give it a 90 out of 100 on the Kyle scale. It is, it's probably, I don't know. I would say it's in my top 250 or something like that. Like it's
in my top 250.
Because I've tried to do a top 100 before, and it's like I've run out of.
In fairness, it's in my top 250,000.
I could name 200.
I've watched far, far too many movies. If such a thing is possible, and. It's a good film. I feel like everyone should watch it. I think there's a lot of artistic value there. And if you like Nicolas Cage, you gotta see it. If you like Nicolas Cage even a little bit, and Nick Cage has made some movies that are good, and then he's made some that are atrocious. You know, I like Con Air, for example. I just like it. I think it's funny. I think it's like I like the love story. He's this sort of damaged fucking. You know, the whole reason he's in prison is like defending his wife in a bar fight and everything. And he just seems like a nice guy. He is a nice guy. And then you got Steve Buscemi as like the lovable child murderer, you know, it's fucking, you got Danny Trejo in there as like Johnny 27 or something like that. Cause he's raped 27 women, you know, like just a real despicable piece of shit. You got John Malkovich as like, I think Cyrus the Virus. Might be his like prison name, and he's somehow the second most evil guy on the airplane, Cyrus the Virus, you know, because Danny Trejo is like just abominable.
Professional rapist.
They've got the one like female guard, and Danny Trejo is just like all about like becoming Johnny 28 or whatever the fuck. And even Cyrus the Virus
is going to be Johnny 100.
Yeah. and John Malkovich is like, Jesus, look, easy with the rape. Let's get free first. Like you can do all the raping you want when we get out of here. Let's just concentrate on getting free. It's a good one.
Okay.
I like it.